Just a little bit. I'm going to read from the epilogue because I never get to read from that part of the book. So it's from the last part of the book. This is actually used to be, or parts of this used to be, the start of the book. And it was in a prologue, but nobody ever reads prologues. So it turned into kind of the last chapter of the book. And this book is about a black family from Boston that moves to a nearly all-white town in the Berkshires in Western Massachusetts in the early 1990s, and they move there to take part in an experiment where they're teaching sign language to a chimpanzee. And the book skips around in different time periods. It starts out in the early 1990s. The family has two daughters, Charlotte and Callie. And so this part that I'm reading from is from the perspective of of Charlotte as an adult in 2011. Beside me on my desk, there's a raw chicken liver in a red velvet jewelry box. The box is just large enough to fit the meat, but a pinch of flesh is caught in one of the metal hinges, and the little gilt clasp that closes the box strains against the hump of liver. The whole thing, box and liver, softly stinks. This morning, before I sat down at the computer, I took the box out of the refrigerator where it has nestled for the last few days between a quart of raspberry kefir and a plastic pint of alfalfa sprouts. When my wife, Darla, saw me put it on my desk so early, long before I was supposed to take off, she wrinkled her nose. "Jesus, Charlotte," Darla said, "is that really necessary?" "I don't want to forget it," I told her, but she knew, of course, I would never forget. "You could have just kept it in the fridge. I would make sure you took it." The velvet box is from the Christmas present Darla gave me last year. The present was a necklace made of a flat gold chain. I wear the necklace now, but when I got that present, I was most excited about that box and wished I'd gotten it a few weeks earlier. When we were cleaning up last year, I slipped the box into the plastic shopping bags we keep in the hall closet, stuffed with throwaway bows and scraps of wrapping paper and dead rolls of scotch tape, and I thought about that red velvet box all year long. But still, I put off getting into the car until the last possible moment, until I will most certainly be late. Instead, I sit at my desk with my present of chicken liver and answer email. Before that, I was Googling Charlie and the Toneybee. I only allow myself to do this once a year, this time of year, and every year I find a little bit more. In the years since we left the Toneybee and I have grown and graduated from college and made my small life in the world, the story has moved out of my reach. It's all because of the internet. Online, there are those who remember the experiment and those who discover it, and usually those are the people I've learned to avoid. Racial militants, animal militants, trivia buffs, fans of great apes, the relentlessly quirky. Once a year, I search and I find our family in posts with titles like Top 10 Wackiest Sacrifices for Science and 53 Weirdest Childhood Pets. I read the lists and then I will myself not to read the comments. Sometimes someone finds my email address and sends me a question. They track down the Toneybee's report of the experiment, or they've read Man or Beast for some college seminar. They write to ask if all of it is true. I don't write back to the cranks or the ones with a mission, but I respond to the softball questions. What was it like having a chimp for a brother? I learned you can't really answer much more than that. You have to stop the questions there before things get weird. Things always get weird. Usually people are just ramping up, waiting to steer the conversation toward what they really want to talk about, some form of race baiting or speculation about hygiene, or inevitably questions about sex. To stop any of that from happening, I make a crack about the smell. I write, "Having a chimp for a brother stinks." I like imagining the groans that greet that awful pun. "What was it like having a chimp for a brother?" they write, and I write back, "It was a wonderful experience. I would not trade it for the world. It was really something special. My sister and I are grateful." 20 minutes before I should leave, I get up from my desk and take great interest in fishing a broken tea bag out of the garbage disposal. When I pass through the living room, Darla says from the couch, "Just go already, you're making it worse by stalling." Darla isn't coming, even though it was she who bought the cut of meat, not me. It was she who made sure it was a good one. She's never once asked to come with me on these trips. She said instead, "I'll go if you want me to." And I love her, I love her, I love her for caring so much and doing me the kindness of pretending not to. In the car at the first spotlight, I take out my phone and peck out an apology that spills over into four texts, explaining why I am running late. The reply buzzes back immediately, a single stoic K. 15 minutes later, I'm parked at the base of the stairs to Callie's apartment. I text her again, press send, but she does not reply. I just hear her front door slam a few flights above me, and then I see her slowly making her way down the stone staircase. Callie lives on the other side of the city from me, just outside of Boston, in one of those Somerville apartments built into the side of a hill. Her building is at the very top of a steep rise, with a narrow concrete staircase set deep into the earth, clambering up to the front door. Callie lives at the very top of the building, up in the clouds, far removed. She's never invited me and Darla to her house. She's never invited our parents either. She doesn't talk to any of us of friends or lovers, but it is a safe bet that she does not have any of either. As far as any of us know, in all the years she's lived there, Callie has never had a house guest. She walks down the stairs sideways, rolling each hip forward and carefully making sure each foot falls fully on the step below it. As we've grown up, she's only added to the weight she put on at the Toneybee, and so she is extra careful on the steep stairs. She has two shopping bags slung in the crooks of her arms. She keeps a third plastic bag close to her chest. She's wearing a purple felt overcoat and black baggy pants and a shiftless black wool sweater. Callie only wears black now. Her hair is threaded into a million micro braids that wisp around her full, pretty face and end abruptly in a severe bob down around her chin. When she's finished her slow progress down the stairs, she unceremoniously dumps all these bags in the back seat of my car before throwing herself in the front. While she settles in beside me, I scan her for evidence of her secret life. There's a flurry of animal hairs, fine and white and bright on the black of her sweater. I see that she has on one black sock and one pink. "Your socks don't match," I make a point of signing to her when we are together. I am hoping that if I say it with my hands, it will seem more like a gentle ribbing, not an accusation. But it doesn't work that way. Callie waits, allows herself a bristle. Then she says very distinctly, making her voice full and round, "I didn't get to laundry this week." She has never gotten to laundry in all the weeks she's lived alone. She hasn't signed to me since we left the Toneybee over 20 years ago. I start the car, make it out of the city, and pull onto the turnpike. Callie turns on the radio loud as soon as she can. She picks the most obnoxious channel possible, a news station with periodic updates of traffic, the advertisements too loud. WINS, the Winds of New England, says the announcer with a heavy Boston accent. I take my hand off the steering wheel. "Do we have to listen to this?" "Yes," Callie says simply, but she's smiling. This is rare. I always offend her, but she has decided not to be right now, which is a blessing, so I take it. "Dad's good," I say, giving up on signing. Callie only nods. Callie would like to believe that she is the only one who still lives at the Toneybee in her heart, who goes through the experiment every day in her mind, but she is not. Still, she won't give our father the satisfaction of sharing this grief. He does not try to work past her reserve. He believes it is a just punishment, one that is his right he should endure. He accepts it meekly, but that does not mean he doesn't rage in his heart about it, or rather, in his heart and to me. "How's work?" I say, and watch Callie's shoulders rise up, realizing instantly that I have made a grave mistake. "Work," she says distinctly, "does not exist." I should ask her why work does not exist, but she's trained all of us not to ask any questions about her personal life. Even the names and numbers of her cats are off limits, and she has told me long ago that she does not like it when I brag about my life, as she puts it, so any conversation about myself is off limits as well. I have nothing to brag about. My life is as odd and small and secretive as Callie's. I, too, live in a very small room at the top of a very tall house, all of it outside of my price range. I'm a lab technician at an eye doctor's in downtown Boston. The difference between Callie and me is that I have Darla. Darla, who is not black but Indian, not from New England but California, cannot sign and has never expressed the desire to learn. We met in college, and her complete otherness from me made me fall in love with her, has dulled, turned warm, and now I love her for what we share. She's not an animal lover, thank God. Still, it took her a while to realize I was not joking when I told her I do not want to have children because they only end up doing awful things. When I first met Darla, when we were young, I thought nobody would ever remember the Toneybee. Darla had never heard of it, and when I told her about it, all of it, she was more sickened by the story than fascinated. Besides her, I only told it to a few of our friends, and then in strictest confidence. And then came the internet, and we are known again, or believed to be known. And I'll stop there. Cool.
So, that section originally existed as a prologue. When did you find that piece of the narrative? Was that something that you knew once you finished the book, or did it come to you in the middle?
Well, when I was thinking about the book and the and what I wanted the kind of the main secret to be that's the center of the book, it's hard to write a narrative about a secret these days because a lot of things are uncoverable by Google or by people just doing really easy research. Information or pieces of information can be readily available. So it was an attempt to explain how the secret could have stayed a secret for these characters for so long. So it's more for myself to try and figure out the logistics of that technically in the book. And so after kind of a couple drafts, it became clear that it didn't necessarily need to be at the start of the book, that part has to be explained at some point, but it could come at the end. It didn't have to necessarily be at the start. Mm-hmm. It's a pretty boring answer.
What about the red velvet box with the meat in it?
Yeah.
Like, was that something that you, was that an image that you had for a while?
I was reading a lot about how often zoo animals get really weird presents from zookeepers. So in the winter, every hot heat wave, they'll show on the news zookeepers giving animals blood popsicles or whatever, just weird stuff like that. But the Brooklyn Zoo in Prospect Park, during Christmas time, they give their animals wrapped presents that just contain raw meat, and it's you're not allowed, it's not for visitors to see, visitors don't see it, they just do it. Mm-hmm. I guess for the humans to feel they're part of a seasonal thing or whatever. But so I was thinking about that a lot, and then just the image of a piece of meat shoved into a gift box came to mind.
Well, there's something that's really attractive about this. You have this sort of very nice velvet box, and inside is this disgusting flesh,
yeah.
Right? And the reason I bring it up is that one of the ways this book is sort of conceptualized, right, is that you have this really disgusting image, mm-hmm. right, of black people as, chimps.
Mm-hmm.
And it sort of sits against this very, how does it, the way it sits with reality in a way reminds me of the way that meat sits in that box right now.
Mm-hmm.
So can you talk a little bit about, first, what it's like to write to that kind of imagery, always having that with you throughout this book?
Well, it's really difficult. I mean, this book took a long time to write, in part because I wanted to write about that painfulness and that kind of revulsion, and then also that awkwardness around the revulsion. So it requires you to feel those things while you're writing, and it's not really pleasant to feel those things while you're writing. So it took a long time to work through that. And I think having those things in a novel, we talked about this a lot in, I think, our grad school experience, is if you choose to put upsetting things in a novel, why are you choosing to do this? Is it just to prove that you can? Is it just for shits and giggles? Why are you putting an image or something into the world? And I a good guess that I would have is that question becomes much more pressing when you are writing a novel versus through other art forms, making a movie or acting a scene or something like that. You're forced to sit with certain images and certain repercussions for a long time because you have to rewrite and you have to really think about where things are going, and it's all on you. You're not delegating things to other people. Mm-hmm. You're not coming up with a really disgusting scene and then going to a set designer and saying find me the best blood you can or something like that. So you have to find that yourself in your own mind, which is not a very pleasant thing to do all the time. So it's a, when you start to write towards those things, part of the work is actually putting it on the page and making sure that it's done well. And then the other part of it is, I think if you have a conscience at all, is to ask yourself continually, why are you doing this? Or what is the reason for yourself? Not even what's the reason for another reader, but what's the reason for yourself for doing it?
What is the reason for yourself?
I think for myself, the reason is to write about things that feel like you can't talk about, or that you feel like have to go unsaid, or things that...
Is it weird in this moment now that I force you to talk about it?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I think that so much of... We're in a really weird cultural moment right now where people like to traffic in, like, I'm the only one saying the stuff that nobody else will say. Like, everybody, a lot of people, like, preface what they're trying to say with that. But, of course, all of that still runs along lines of convention, right? Like, there are still things that, no matter what your political persuasion, you probably don't say in public or wouldn't say in public. And so I'm always really interested in those things that are still kind of outside of, truly outside of what people feel comfortable talking about or really actually just sitting with, you know? Like, I think there are some things that people are okay just kind of like blurting out to like freak out the room or whatever, but to actually like sit with it, like, okay, like, what does that mean? Let's talk about that for like 20 or 30 minutes or an hour. You know, that's a harder thing that most people don't really want to do.
Do you feel like having written this book and then bringing it out into the world and in some ways having to stand for it, right? Has the book deepened or changed you? Has the book deepened or changed you, and or are there parts of the book that still in a way remains unknown to you?
I think there are parts of the book, the parts of the book that remain unknown are some of the choices that the characters make and some of their, the things that they decide or decide not to do. Like, I can come up with reasons of why I think that they're doing those things, but I think some of that is still kind of elusive or out of reach. And then in terms of, like, changing, I don't necessarily think that it has, it hasn't really changed, but it has, I think, forced me to articulate more clearly some of the things that I observe or that led to the book being coming together, I guess.
You mentioned our time at Hunter. We got a few people in the back there. This is actually something I've been meaning to talk to you about for a while, it's serious. No.
Okay.
And I've actually just been holding on to this question
for 10 million G-chats to like get this out of your system, but okay.
I'm really curious about what it's like, what it was like at Hunter, right? And being a writer, writing this book, and what it's like now, and the book is out in the world. Because it's, you know, we were all in different stages in our life. We were in different... definitely a different political climate. So if you could just speak to if there is a difference between your life then and your life now.
Oh, I mean, a huge, like, just like in life, just a huge difference. But I mean, I think the difference maybe is thinking about how a book enters the world, and you can't really control that at all. I think, you know, like, you know that on like a logical level, but on a kind of like a gut level, that's hard to understand. And I mean, because for me, what attracts me to writing is, and to writing fiction in particular, is that you have complete control over what you're working on. I have an older sister who is a playwright. And we'll talk about writing sometimes, and she'll say, "Oh, I wrote this play, but it's never going to be produced because, I wrote in a scene where a flood has to happen on stage, and like that's just unstageable. That's not going to happen." Whereas if you're a fiction writer, you can put a flood on stage. Who gives what's going to happen? It doesn't matter. You're not bound by rules or budgets or kind of anything like that. So there's a autonomy in your work that does not necessarily translate into, I mean, it doesn't translate into any sort of autonomy over how your book is going to enter the world or how people are going to respond to your work at all. And so that's, that was something that I was preparing myself for sure, knowing what the book was about and knowing how easily it can be misinterpreted or misread. And so just like thinking about the best, in my response to that was to write something that at least I could feel was the best thing that I could do, so that at least I felt like I could defend whatever it was that I was writing. Mm-hmm. But I think as you know, the current, you mentioned like we're in a different climate, and I think, you know, we talk about this a little bit. Bill and I teach a class together now, and we taught a class at Sackett's like last winter around this time, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Together. And so we've talked a lot about I guess how your work can feel like it takes on a certain importance about how much more on the line stuff feels right now in terms of what you're stating in the world and what you're, I mean, not to get like woo-woo about it, but like what intentions you're stating towards the world in your work. And so I think the difference is probably that I've always kind of felt that about work, but at this point I think it's probably even more heightened in terms of what are the things that you're going to focus your energy on and what are the stories that you're going to focus your energy on. I mean, I think a few weeks ago we were talking back and forth about wanting to write stories that are both, I mean, this is me saying this, I don't know.
Let's sort of speak to our current political.
Stories that speak to our current political process, but or our current political moment, but also that it's more difficult to write those stories with, for lack of a cheesy term, but it's more difficult to write those stories with hope involved. It's much more easy to write, you know, the darkest dystopian fiction ever. Like, that is a very easy thing to write right now. We're living in it. Like, and so what do you do? I think the real challenge is how do you write something that speaks to the moment that we're in, that can imagine a better future. So,
I mean, it seems to me that, you know, I'm sure there are more than a few writers in the room, but something about fatalism is actually really easy to write.
Yeah.
Right, because we're sort of ingesting it all the time.
And also, I mean, fatalism, you know how it ends, right?
Yeah.
We're dead. Like, it's a really easy ending. Yeah. It's done for you. And so it's much harder to imagine viable endings that an intelligent person would believe in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Would you consider yourself an optimist?
No.
Yeah. I don't even know why. I already knew the answer to that. So, you know, with that being said, right, how long has it been since grad school? About 8 years, 9 years, something mm-hmm. like that? Is there a piece of advice, if you could go back, to give a younger version of yourself?
I don't know, stop worrying so much. Life is good 8 years ago. Just hang out. It's really going to be okay. Yeah, I mean, I think also giving yourself time. I think like last spring I went to a reading by Robin Coast Lewis, who wrote Journey of the Sable Venus. It's a really great poetry collection. She was talking about how... first of all, how long it took her to write that collection. And she was also describing, she's translating a Sanskrit poem. And she needs to reteach herself Sanskrit to do it. And she's estimated that it's probably going to take her 20 years to translate this poem. And she just said it very matter of fact, like, that's just how long it's going to take. You know, like, that's the amount of work that it's going to take to do X. So. I think respecting that art and writing exists kind of on their own timeline. You know, we oftentimes, because art is really devalued in our current culture, I think there's the argument back that, like, there's measurable outcomes from, like, art or work of some sort. And there is when you're talking about, like, you know, obviously producing a book or like selling a book or something like that. But in terms of like actually just allowing yourself to do the work, art and writing exist outside of, you know, any kind of efficient mode that we can think of. They don't really exist inside of those economies. And it's really hard to wrap your head around that when you are in the middle of writing something and just want it to be over or done with or done in time or whatever your internal timeline is. You know, that's kind of the magical thing about it. There's no actual use for it in the world. Like, there's no utilitarian use for it in the world. And that's actually what's really wonderful about it. It's outside of that system of thinking.
I think there's also this, you know, that pressure to produce, right, is that for a lot of us, it's just bound so much in identity, right? Whereas if it were something like, if we were conceptualized as a practice, right, like worship almost, then there wouldn't be this strange anxiety to keep up with the pack.
Yeah.
Note to self. Okay. So we talked a little bit about teaching, and we've taught a couple of things together. Do you like teaching?
Yeah, actually I do. I used to say that I really didn't like it, but I do actually like it. Yeah. I like teaching with you. It's fun to teach with another person in the classroom.
That's true.
Yeah.
What do you think about our students?
What kind of question is that?
Okay. Let me laser in. Is there something, you know? Do you see, if you look at this, the young writers sitting in our classrooms, either at Hunter or at Sackett Street? What do you see in common among them, or what do you see that's hopeful?
I mean, I think what's hopeful is that there are people desperately wanting to engage with literature and with books, and I think, you know, there's millions of news stories about how the novel's dying and literature is dying and books are dying, but I think what's really wonderful about teaching those classes is that you're with a group of people who are passionately still interested in reading and writing and just really talking about books. And those people exist everywhere. They're not just in our class, but to have those like a set aside time during the week to kind of have that is really nice and special.
I mean, part of we both went through the MFA process, right? Is there something in your mind, you know, both having gone through it and now teaching at that level, something that would that defines an ideal MFA candidate, like a young writer? Mm-mm. No?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I think it's just, you know, I think it's a willingness to do the work, probably. But I mean, that's kind of the need for any position that you're gonna be a part of. But I think probably that's it. I mean, I think there's a lot of different reasons why people do writing programs. And I was doing a talk at AWP like 2 weekends ago. I did it with actually Tennessee, another person we went to grad school with, and Tiffany Anik and Carrie Carnahan. And the subject was writers raised poor and working class who chose like a position in the arts or chose to go into the arts. And it was less of a panel and more like a giant therapy session. It was actually really cool, really fun. One of the things that we talked about was like this desire to, especially if you're talking about MFA programs, to like legitimize yourself very quickly because of that thing that we were talking about earlier, because of that need to look like an efficient working writer. And so I think if you are entering a program for that reason and that reason alone, sometimes it doesn't really work out too well because you really have to be there to be doing work regardless. It's not so much about proving to other people that you are legitimately a writer unless you're there to actually kind of produce work, but just to be there to be able to say I'm an MFA student is sometimes doesn't really work out that well. Mm-hmm. Which is to say that I think the only advice that I would give to people, or the only thing
that I think makes an ideal MFA student is that you have to be there at a time where you're actually emotionally and mentally able to do the work, which is hard to judge about yourself. You know, that's part of what being there is that you learn those patterns, internal patterns of yourself, of when you're able to emotionally handle it. If you go too early in life, I think you can lose that internal barometer of when you're ready and able to do work. You know, like there's that really great, which I send to you like every 3 weeks, I feel like, over G-Chat, which is really great. Gino Diaz quote where he's talking about how so much of being in, especially if you are if you're going to college, especially if you're a first generation college student, but really I think it's true for everybody, that being in certain institutions to drive yourself to do the work, so many of us, he says, go towards the whip, which is like being like, you got to work faster, you got to work harder, you're such a fucking idiot, what are you doing, you dummy, like just work. If this is how you know if you're in a not great institution, is if that kind of self-talk is rewarded, mm-hmm. and if that kind of way of producing work is encouraged. And his point is that can only get you so far. That gets you to do work maybe for 1 or 2 years at a time, but that's not sustainable over a life unless you become a really horrible person. And you have to find another way to motivate yourself. Hopefully out of love, but you have to find another way to motivate yourself to get your work done.
Hmm. Something that I've seen in your trajectory, right? You know, as the book is coming out and after the book's come out, is that you've been doing a lot more essays, a lot more sort of memoir pieces. Can mm-hmm. you talk to us a little bit about part of that, like why that shift has occurred and what it's like in comparison to fiction?
Part of it has occurred because, like I said, I have an older sister who is a playwright and then a middle sister who's a historian, and both of them have scavenged our family history for their own work. So I couldn't really write an autobiographical, it felt like I couldn't write an autobiographical novel or an obviously autobiographical novel because both of them either research parts of family history or have already written many dramatic works about parts of family history taken directly from it. So writing nonfiction is a way to kind of talk about those things that I still find interesting, but feel like I couldn't fictionalize because they already kind of exist in other people's work. Nonfiction is also, I'm kind of obsessed with pop culture for a really long time. And so writing nonfiction is also just another way to kind of express those obsessions. When I was like in middle school, I used to be really obsessed with reading like cultural critics. Like I had like a bunch of stuff from like Village Voice columnists and like stuff like that. It was like in like really just loved reading that stuff. And it was a lot harder to get to when I was younger because we didn't have the internet. So like if you were super into like movie trivia history, you had to go like take out a movie trivia like encyclopedia from the library, like a huge dork, and like read it and memorize, you know, everybody's thoughts on whatever. So part of it is just going back to those old obsessions that mm-hmm. are kind of around.
Is it harder? I mean, do you find it's, I don't want to say like, is it more vulnerable, but is there a like difficulty that doesn't exist in fiction, or is it about the same?
I think the difficulty is referring to the other people in my life. So, you know, like my sister gets very sanctimonious and she's always like, my life is not my own to tell, blah, blah, whatever. So you feel kind of the same way though, like you can't, you know, if you want to write about something that's really interesting that like a friend has said or a family member has said, it's kind of figuring out how to talk about it while also still protecting their privacy. And then I think another part of it, of course, is like the danger of writing about yourself is that, of course, you're like the number one unreliable narrator, so you really have to make sure that you are presenting yourself in a fair light. And so that means both like making sure that you aren't the like obvious hero of the story. You don't give yourself all the best lines, but then also that you are not overcompensating by making yourself into like some sort of horrible monster where like you're just self-deprecating the entire time. And like, so you have to find a really good balance, and then also you have to make agreements with yourself about what you're willing to tell about yourself and what you're willing not to. So.
We were talking a little bit earlier about that, the new James Baldwin movie. Mm-hmm. If anyone hasn't seen it, go see it. So here's a quote. Okay. History is not something you read about in a book. History is not even the past. It's the present, because everybody operates, whether or not we know it, out of assumptions which are produced and produced only by our history. Do you agree or disagree?
1,000%. Yes.
Yeah. How does that, I mean, you studied history. That was your major?
Mm-hmm.
How much of that informs the way you think about fiction and the way you think about, you know, portraying power structures and identity in books?
It's everything. I mean, one of the reasons why I started writing fiction is because all of these really interesting things that I would learn about history, I would want to have other people know about. And it seemed like the method to get the most people to learn about it would be to write it in a novel form, as opposed to like writing a history book, which nobody would pick up. So it's a huge part of it. And I think understanding both just the facts of history, but then also understanding how history is made, is a really important part of it, and understanding how how we construct narratives and how popular and how powerful those narratives are, so that you can recognize when they're being constructed for you, and then also that you can start to play with, if you're a creator of something, you can start to play with the expectations of those narratives. And I think history is, if you are, particularly if you're a fiction writer, history is just kind of it's like a bonanza for you to kind of work with and to move within. Not that we should all just only be writing historical novels, but I think, I just think it's a huge resource, and there's a reason why people are uninterested in teaching it to people, because it could do a whole bunch of good if people had it.
Mm-hmm. What would you say is the history that we're creating today? Like, what is the narrative of our country? Kind of a big question.
That's a big question. I mean, I think what we're seeing right now is some people being very disturbed, because for a long time our narrative has been unbroken progress. And if you are a student of history, you know that that's not how human history goes. You know, it goes in cycles. And it continually comes back, I think a lot of people assumed that there's like a laissez-faire attitude to progress, that like, number one, like all those bad people are going to die off soon and it'll be okay and you don't have to worry about it, and just like kind of let things go on. And I think we obviously know that's not true. And then I think a huge part of reconciling that we have to do at this current moment is to realize that, progress, it doesn't just run on fumes. Like, you have to be continually working towards it. So like, if you truly believe in a racially integrated America, you have to take actions towards that. You can't just kind of say that sounds good and then like go back home to your segregated neighborhoods or whatever. You have to actually start to look around you and think about like, what are the changes that I could do in my life to make that a reality. And I think one of the things that we do have going for us, if you study history as well, is that there are so many people who have fought the same things that we're facing right now. And unfortunately, we don't necessarily always, their stories aren't widely known, but then I think that's the responsibility of the people who are in this room to figure out a way to write about those stories as truthfully as possible and not turn them into, you know, saints or people who are untouchable, but to really kind of wrestle with the knots that those people wrestled with to help our current moment figure out how we're gonna get through. Yes.
All right. Thanks.
Yeah. Well, my job's done. It's all your turn. Any questions?
Oh, what a great question from the Algonquin corner. I'm working on a second book, which is going to be a retelling of the myth of Persephone, but it's set in 19th century Haiti and 19th century New York City.
Is Greek mythology big for you? Because it shows up in the book.
Yeah, I have this book of, it's like the standard big picture book of Greek myths that I had when I was growing up, and we got it right around the summer my parents were divorcing, and so I read it like obsessively that summer. So yeah, I love myths and mythology, and also it helps to have a framework for a story already set out to kind of work with, which is a new way to write and kind of a new challenge to try and set up. Hi, Scott. Yeah. Oh, sorry.
No, I was just going to ask a question, because I like hearing you talk.
Oh.
So let's get to
okay.
Well, it's about that juvenile book. Mm-hmm. So what is your motivation? And has it changed? And does that change, or is it changing now?
My motivation is the whip. It's like saying, you're so terrible at writing, and what are you doing, and why are you writing this, and blah, blah. And it's not sustainable over time. Like, you don't produce good work when you're thinking that way. So for me, it's trying to continually, when I do sit down and write, to, it's like reprogramming your brain to think about the things that you want the work to be doing, or like what you want the work to be saying, or how you want the work to come into the world, I guess. That's the only way, I guess. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Hi. Thank you so much for this conversation. And I had a question. I think as someone who kind of comes out, at least in years ago, in more like activism and like in that kind of energy, and always having this idea of like wanting to do something, shape, change, make change, do things like that. And so I wonder if you could talk about like how do you see stories or storytelling and that particular function, like their particular function and purpose in sort of shaping like shaping landscapes and shaping our shaping worlds and stuff like that.
I think they're very important, but I think sometimes we give them too much importance and too much power. Like, stories are wonderful and great, but they don't do anything without organized political action. Like, that's a real thing that needs to happen in the world. But I think if you can think of the stories as something going hand in hand with both, you can't have all of one or all of the other. So much of what organizes people are narratives that they tell themselves that actually sometimes don't even exist yet. So like, if you think of something like the abolitionist movement, which you had people who were able to imagine black people living free in the US, which in huge numbers, which didn't exist at all, and hadn't existed. And you had people imagining that 200 years before that could even exist. And so there are these huge leaps of imagination that happen from like a very small groups of people that can influence, the whole world, a whole society, a whole culture. And that's a really beautiful thing. But I mean, the flip side of that is that there are leaps of imagination that can be based not at all in reality, that are really harmful and hurtful for people. And I think as much as we can tell stories that are engaging and interesting and also recognize the complexities that we're all living with, I think that's kind of the most important thing. Because I think a lot of times people get very excited or you know, even if this question of like representation of people in movies or people in books or marginalized people being represented, and then there's always like, you didn't represent them correctly, or like you made them to have too many flaws, or you didn't give them enough flaws or whatever. I think a huge part of it is, where was I going with that? I think a huge part of it is recognizing that, you know, it takes many, many stories to kind of describe a certain reality, and to it's kind of like a culmination of a bunch of things. And so having patience with stories, I guess, and recognizing their limits of what they can and can't do. And all the wonderful things that stories and literature can do, but stories and literature also don't change necessarily corporal realities. Like, that's up to us human beings to do actual real actions. And stories can inspire us to do that, but they in and of themselves are not the work that needs to be done. So, you know, being happy and proud to write stories, but also recognizing that that doesn't mean that our work in the world is done once we've written something. Yeah. Do you have a question?
Mine was kind of a fake question.
Okay. It's a plant.
Well, I love your saying that you can't write about your family because your sister's appropriation of information, and I thought your novel is so assured and so not like a typical debut novel, maybe because you were swept away from all of those personal details, and I thought, is this really your debut novel? That's my question.
Yeah.
Is there that secret family novel that you can't let your sister see?
No. Yeah, this is the first one. I mean, it took a long time to write, so I feel like it kind of is a debut novel, and that like the one that feels like a little bit blurrier is within this. It just got rewritten over the years, but... But yeah, I think...
Well, it is a family novel.
It's a family novel. And I should say, like, my mom got asked to raise my sister with a chimpanzee. I mean, it's totally from family history. Like, there are parts of it that are parts of it. So, but I think recognizing the space between your own history and kind of what you can imagine was really the place where the book started to come together for me. And I think, you know, there's like a saying, and our professor used to say it to us a lot, and I think it's kind of like just a truism, that everybody in the world has like a book and a half in them. So like most people could probably write a book about their life in some sort of form, either in fiction or memoir, but it's that pushing yourself a little bit further to imagine things outside of yourself from within yourself that is kind of the difficult thing, and the thing that sustains work past that first kind of thing that you can kind of push out of yourself, I guess. Any other questions? Oh, yeah.
What branch of history did you study?
I studied U.S. history, and I studied free black communities in the North, like in the antebellum period.
Thank you very much, Bill and Kaitlyn.